So this is the third annual meeting of the Catholic Immigrant Integration Initiative, and we're grateful to you all for being here today. And this is the very first panel of the day, and this is an initiative that has three focuses right now, and one of those focuses is how do we measure the success of Catholic and faith-based agencies and their work with immigrants and on immigrant integration, on immigrant well-being, and on immigrant empowerment. And that's what our panel is called. It's called Assessing and Measuring the Success of Catholic Organizations with Immigrants. This is a complex issue, and its complexity is reflected on the panel today. And part of the complexity of measuring success is attempting to speak to a wide range of Catholic institutions, programs, and ministries. On this panel, we have a scholar who has examined the social impact of Catholic school closings. We have a priest who works in the labor movement and has been revitalizing an important Catholic labor ministry. We have the director of a very sophisticated set of resettlement legal and language programs for large Catholic charities in the Northeast. And we have a Catholic charity director whose agency has been lauded for its emergency and other services in the Rio Grande Valley. Generally, we would hope that faith-based institutions would exceed the normal or secular, if you want to call it that, metrics for success, both in terms of outputs and in terms of the long-term outcomes for the people that they serve. But it's obviously true that Catholic agencies have deeper and different goals related to building community, to evangelizing culture, and to promoting human dignity and integral development. And I hope that some of this complexity will emerge from our discussion today. We also hope that the program can begin to provide some concrete guidance to faith-based institutions that work with immigrants. So let me introduce our terrific panelists. And the way we're going to do this is they'll speak for 10 to 15 minutes each. And we have in the front row a timekeeper, Reese Johnson, so he's going to be the policeman today. And the first is Professor Margaret Grinning, Peg Grinning, who's a professor of law at the University of Notre Dame School of Law. And she's also the author of this terrific new book. It's called Lost Classrooms, Lost Community. And it's a study of the effect of Catholic school closings on poor urban communities. So a lot of scholars have talked about the Catholic school advantage for students, but she's looking beyond the school walls, and she's looking to the importance of Catholic schools, actually to the communities where they're located. So very fascinating study. Peg is also at the Institute for Educational Initiatives at Notre Dame, and she's a special advisor to Archbishop Supich. Excuse me, that's part of it, I'm sorry. Maybe Peg will be after this, who knows? Yeah, and Father, so to her left is Father Cleet Kiley, who's a priest at the Archdiocese of Chicago, and he is a special advisor to Archbishop Supich. Since 2010, Father Kiley has served as a director for immigration policy at Unite Here, working on immigration reform with the nation's union leadership and its local members. He also leads a project to train a new generation of Catholic labor priests. Previously, he was the president and CEO of the Faith and Politics Institute, and he served as the executive director of the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, Secretariat for Priestly Life and Ministry. To the far left, Margie Perbeau directs the Refugee and Immigration Services Division of Catholic Charities for the Archdiocese of Boston. Margie has been doing this work since 1995, and she's responsible for the Community Interpreter Services Program, which is a social enterprise of Catholic Charities. Andover, the Immigration Legal Services program there, which is a very large and robust program, and their Refugee Resettlement program. She also works with the president of Catholic Charities to measure and report on the agency-wide performance of Catholic Charities to the Board of Trustees. And then finally, last but not least, Sister Norma Pimentel, who's a sister with the Missionaries of Jesus, and she's the executive director of Catholic Charities of the Rio Grande Valley. And I hope she doesn't mind me saying this, because this is what she told me, that people are now coming up to her and saying that this is the Pope's nun. I said, right? That she was, as you, many of you know, she was featured in ABC Report, 2020 Report. Her work in the valley was with unaccompanied minors in particular, was lifted up in a very beautiful way. And the Holy Father thanked her for that work, and thanked the work of all the religious sisters through her. So what she does is she oversees the charitable arm of the Diocese of Brownsville, which provides emergency assistance, disaster relief, homelessness prevention services, clinical counseling, pregnancy care, food programs, and has the Humanitarian Respite Center. She also chairs the local emergency food and shelter program that distributes federal funds to local agencies, providing assistance to the area's poor, and she serves as co-vicar of religious in the Diocese of Brownsville. So we're going to ask each of these folks to speak in order, 10 to 15 minutes each, and then we're going to leave a lot of time at the end for an exchange and dialogue with you. Thank you.
Thank you all so much for being here and also for inviting me. I feel sort of out of place because I don't speak Spanish and I don't really know much about immigration, although I'm learning from all of you, and I'm very much a northerner, but I was delighted to see that I'm back at the home of the fighting Irish. My co-author, Nicole, couldn't be here today. She's actually more involved in the Center for Educational Initiatives than I, and they had an important board meeting today. What I want to talk to you about is something that presents at once an obstacle and an opportunity for Catholic institutions, and it's whether or not parochial schools, Catholic schools, can actually step up to the plate and help immigrants as they have for the centuries that they've been in place in the United States. Okay, let's see if this is a little steadier. My work has been done in Chicago, in Philadelphia, and in Los Angeles, so I can't really say too much about exactly what's going on in Texas, but I can talk to you generally about how Catholic schools historically have lifted immigrants like my ancestors out of poverty and into success in the United States. What Nicole and I feel is that the continued success of this effort relies on three things: leadership, that is the connection between the administrator of the parish, because most of the schools are parish run, and the principal of the school, as well as other community resources that may be involved in keeping the schools funded and vital. In ministering particularly to Latinos, as I'll talk about in a minute, and is particularly relevant here, because one of the things that we found is that schools in Chicago and Philadelphia were more likely to close as neighborhoods became more Latino, and less likely to close, or more so than if they became African American, even though the African Americans are much less apt to be Catholic. And that's a scary thing. And finally, that they have to, it's not just that the school exists, although that is something, but it has to be a beacon for excellence and a model for how much the Catholic community values those particular students. As you all know, nearly 70% of the active practicing Catholics in the United States under 40 are Latino. However, only 3% of them send their children to Catholic schools. You may know better than I why that is. As far as we can tell, historically, in countries in Latin America that are heavily Catholic, only the elite sent their kids to Catholic schools. And they also do cost something, in sometimes a prohibitive amount for poorer people, sometimes at least something. And people whose resources are being stretched and who are living on financial margins cannot always afford to send their kids there. We found that over 2,000 schools have closed in the United States since the mid-1980s. It's a very large amount. And in places like Chicago, it was about 200 of them, and which was about 40%. And they were very heavily located in the inner city. Partly, this was because there were sometimes four schools on the same block, ministering to different ethnic groups, but all of them were financially troubled. And what we were looking at was what happened when those schools closed and the students got dispersed either to the public schools or to other schools in the neighborhood. What's lost when those networks cease to be? In other neighborhoods, Catholics keep alive, and Catholic schools keep alive, and they act as a beacon of hope. Hope in the parish for another generation, but also faith for the people that live there, that people from outside who may have started those schools continue to believe in them. When they close, sometimes, as one bishop said, it's like the last vestige of civilization shuts down. So what you see is that the networking, what's called social capital in the neighborhoods, declines. They become more graffiti, more drug paraphernalia, more prostitutes hanging out, more broken windows, but eventually more crime. Charter schools, which sometimes replace a Catholic school in the same building and take over right after the schools close, do not do the same thing as neighborhood institutions, at least not yet. So the Catholic schools are a vital, absolutely vital resource for those neighborhoods. This is what happened in Chicago with the crime rate, which declining during the period of time we were looking at, in places that did and didn't have open Catholic schools. So in the ones where there was a Catholic school had closed, that's the red line on top, it's always higher than the lower line, which is where the Catholic schools stayed open. And this is true even if you hold the demographics and the socioeconomic, the money, constant in those schools. You can see it in another way. If the this is actually a measure after doing a what's called regression analysis of how steep the decline in the crime rate was. And I think the top one is the places that had a closed Catholic school, and the bottom one, which is where the Catholic schools remained open, the crime rate is declining faster. It actually, where there were Catholic schools, it declined about 25% during the 6 years we were looking at data, and where the Catholic schools had closed, it was only 17%. So that's a big difference. This is what it looks like with separate crimes, and looking at places that had charter schools and Catholic schools. And again, you see the lower crime rate and greater decline in the places with the open Catholic schools. And the charter schools, it doesn't make any difference whether they're open or whether there aren't any. None of them closed during this period of time. It's true for all of the crimes. When I said that leadership mattered, we found that even when you hold demographics constant, all the schools in Chicago, sorry, Father Kylie, were financially strapped, although one was actually operating in the red during the period of time we were looking at, but that they remained open when the pastor believed in them. When there was a pastor who was indifferent or who would rather close the school and rent out the building to a charter school or turn it into a parking lot or just use the sale of the building to defer maintenance on the churches, which are beautiful in Chicago, the school was about 10 times more likely to close. So that if the pastor and his relationship with the administration of the school was active and vital, they fought to keep those schools open and successfully fought. We found in all different measures that even holding constant, as I said, the proportion Hispanic, the proportion Black, the median income of the neighborhood, that the social capital, the trust that people have in each other, declined when the schools closed. And it was a statistically significant decline. What can we do to fix this? Because this is really a sad story of not caring, letting institutions close that are really vital for something. There are some reasons to believe that we can be hopeful. One of them is that there are some programs, some of them are at my institution at Notre Dame, and the Catholic School Advantage is one of them, that are working to specifically to promote Catholic schools' importance for Latinos. 24 states, including, this is an old number, including Arizona, have some form of voucher, scholarships, tax relief for parents who send their kids to Catholic schools, thus making it affordable for poor students. And others, community, including, for example, Tucson, have very strong partnerships between private philanthropic groups and the Catholic schools, again providing financial aid for them. So I think there is some reason for hope. We think that the future, Nicole and I think that the future of Catholic schools and the vital role that they continue to do in helping new immigrants get the best out of the American experience rests with all of us and is going to require work on our part in talking about what these Catholic schools can do and in making sure that they aren't just there, but that they are really great educational institutions. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. So as Don was introducing me, I think you've got a clear picture that I've been doing a lot of work with priests over a number of years, both at the Bishop's Conference and in the Archdiocese of Chicago. but also recently with labor unions. And for many years, the nexus of organized labor and the Catholic Church was a pretty tightly woven one. Many unions, in fact, started in church basements. Unions, for a long time, were a key element for immigrants and their integration into the broader community through a number of things, providing jobs, training, citizenship classes, and eventually political power. The church also, through its parishes, its schools, as you just heard, through its social agencies, was a major source for integration for immigrants into the broader community. For the past maybe 30 years, that nexus between labor and the church has been frayed. There are a lot of reasons for that. We can go into those at another time. But the fact is, it was a bit frayed. But as we look at the integration of immigrants and we try to figure out some measures of success, I think it's helpful sometimes to go back to the old storehouse. What we used to do in the past, what worked then, might it work again today? Take a look at that. And then there's also a need sometimes just to think outside the box. And that's where I'd like to focus my remarks. Going back to the church's storehouse, what worked in the past? Well, we started to look at that nexus of labor and the church and wondered, was there a way to reactivate that relationship? I began to have conversations with labor leaders, and every one of them would say things to me like, you know, Father, there used to be a lot of labor priests in this country, and they're all dead now, they're all gone. And I found myself saying, well, no, that's not really true. There's a lot of priests very concerned about workers. Maybe the issue is we're not organized. We don't know each other. We don't know where we are. And so we began to start asking questions around and finding different priests. Eventually, about 4 years ago, we gathered 28 priests from around the country in Chicago for a week of training. And in the training, we found, even as we were getting people to accept the invitation, the priests were not interested in talking about unions so much. What got them to come to Chicago for the meeting was that almost every one of them was working in a place with immigrants. And they wanted to come because they were concerned about what was happening to immigrants when they went to work. So that's where we began our conversations with these priests. What was their experience with immigrants, and what were they finding out was happening to them when they went to work? And what they said was, some of the very things described in Rerum Novarum 141 years ago, the same conditions seem to be the effects of daily life for many immigrants when they go to work. Things like wage theft, lack of safety in the workplace, a lot of disrespect, playing with hours. Also in some places with undocumented immigrant workers, there was even child labor going on, things like that. It seemed like nothing had changed in 141 years. And so we began the conversation looking at Catholic social teaching. And then eventually we came to the question of what's the best protection for workers, for immigrants in the workplace. And there was our Catholic social teaching saying it has been and continues to be a union. And all of a sudden, 28 priests who were not so interested in talking about unions were now becoming labor priests. And we saw that even a collective bargaining agreement today can be a layer of protection for undocumented immigrants in the workplace. So we began to have that conversation. We began to train priests. We found, as we listened to priests, we've done about four or five trainings now. We're going to do another one. In fact, next week in Boston. We have 15 priests signed up for a training day there. We've been doing this around the country. We have about 150 priests now who've gone through some kind of training. And again, the threshold over which the priest stepped was this concern about immigrants in the workplace. We've encouraged priests often who had not much Catholic social teaching in their formation in the seminary. Many had no organizing training whatsoever. And that was a key factor. So we built in organizing in the training as well. We've encouraged the priests when they went back home to their parishes to ask the question. They have encuentros with immigrant workers, just to ask the question, what happens? And how does the church respond to that? And to join in with partners regularly. When I mentioned that we wanted to look at the old storehouse, so we're kind of reactivating this whole labor priest network, and it's all about the integration of immigrants in the workplace. Securing their rights and their safety, securing a pathway to citizenship, participation, and an economic democracy, and it's the pathway to political power in the end, which they will need. But I mentioned the second thing is sometimes we have to think outside of the box. And for that, I want to say we have to keep looking at different kinds of partnerships. This is true of the labor movement as it is true of the church. So I'm going to speak from my experience at Unite Here, which is the hotel and restaurant employees union, food service workers and the like. Unite Here has begun a partnership with Clinic. And over the past few months, that partnership has evolved and developed. The union sent two teams of volunteers to work with the clinic-sponsored attorney in Dilley, Texas, which was a marvelous experience, a painful but a marvelous experience for our volunteers who went there. We're also looking to partner with the Archdiocese of Chicago, Unite Here Local 1, with the Pastoral Migratoria in the Archdiocese of Chicago, and again with Clinic, on some citizenship training in the coming year. We're just beginning those kind of conversations. We have to, I guess when I say we have to think outside of the box, we gotta get out of silos. When I'm in church conversations, it's usually, you know, we gotta figure out what we're gonna do as a church. But there's a whole world of other advocates out there who are trying to do something. And I'd say we've got to get out of our silos. I'd have to echo that twice as loud in the labor movement. Labor unions tend to focus on their usual routine of who they deal with. And, you know, encouraging them to get reconnected with a number of the Catholic organizations around immigration issues. The partnerships, I think, are really, really important. And they're probably the best way forward. And let me tell you what happens when the rubber meets the road. Not too long ago in Chicago, just outside in Mundelein, Illinois, there was a food service company that had decided to implement E-Verify. And it was going to affect 100 workers, immigrant workers, many of whom had worked for this company for 10 and 15 years. The company did not inform the union. It violated the collective bargaining agreement in doing that. They continued to proceed to do unfair labor practices. There are six of them that finally were filed. All of a sudden, there were rumors swelling around the place. By June, E-Verify started in January. By June, there was still no information for the workers. So in late June, they called a two-hour strike. They called the union and said, we think ICE is coming, and it was a whole disruptive kind of program. Almost every one of those workers came from our Catholic parishes. And so what happened in a very quick turnaround was that the entire faith community really rose up, paying attention to and bringing attention to the situation. One of the problems was that that ICE, in this case, the Department of Homeland Security, had violated a memorandum of understanding with the Department of Labor, that where there's a labor dispute, they will back off. They didn't back off, even after they were informed there was a hot work site. They persisted. But it was the faith community that really rallied. Bishop Manns led a prayer service in the parking lot of the where the workers were. Elena helped us get the pastoral migratoria folks from Mundelein, came over part of the prayer service, and then also received the representatives of the National Labor Relations Board at the parish in Mundelein. Their committee was there to receive them. They interviewed the workers, and it was a kind of partnership that really worked. And that's what I'm suggesting, that with labor, with the church, we have a lot in common on these issues. The Archbishop wrote a letter to the department, to the Secretary of the Department of Homeland Security. The Franciscans had a rally with Congressman Gutierrez in St. Peter's Church downtown. The media was all over the thing, and of course the media really helps bring attention to something like that. I'm happy to say that three of the workers have been ordered back to work, and the Department of Homeland Security has asked for the rest of the names. We're hopeful that that's all going to get turned around. A lot of that is because of that partnership. The partnerships, I think, are really, really critical to us. And as we look forward, as I said, we continue to mobilize. We'll continue to work on citizenship programs together. We're looking again at how we continue to support the work in Dilley, Texas, the clinic is doing. And I just encourage you all, keep thinking outside of the box. Don't get stuck in a silo. Thank you.
I'm Merjean Farhan. I'm with Catholic Charities, the Archdiocese of Boston, Refugee Immigration Services, and thank you for this opportunity to be here and be on such a distinguished panel. I'm quite in awe of all of you. But what I wanted to do today was talk a little bit about the work that we do in our programs. And what I'd like to start with, if I can figure out this little thingy over here. Put arrows, right? Okay. So what's the framework that we start with? So in thinking about this presentation, I'll admit it went through a number of iterations because we're talking about integration and how to measure the success of that. It dawned on me quite late in the game that the division that I oversee at Catholic Charities really is an example of integration of programs and services. And so this very long-winded run-on sentence here talks about how we have three distinct and overlapping programs that are all designed to help immigrants on their journey. We're treating people with compassion, respect, and dignity. And at the same time, we are working with our national partners as well to integrate national programs at the local level. And so oftentimes, I kind of feel like I have multiple, I wouldn't say bosses, but that's the best word I can think of right now, you know, between the clinic, of being an affiliate of the clinic and upholding their standards, being a partner or affiliate of Catholic Charities USA, and then part of the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops. And so I think we're really uniquely poised to look at how all these large national programs can come together in serving immigrants and refugees. So I was asking some of my colleagues, what do you think of as an integration? And we're going to try to queue up a video, and if the saint of technology, whoever that is on my side today, we'll be able to show you. I want to just show you this really quick clip about a caseworker that works for Catholic Charities right now, and a few words that he said a couple years ago in a video. This is a Karen Baptist church. So the Karini are an ethnic minority group in Burma or Myanmar. And our caseworker, who is actually Buddhist, helped them to start their own church. And now it's a very thriving church in what was a really dying Anglican population in the city of Lynn, Mass.
Thank you.
So this is a federally funded program that is operated by the U.S. Department of State and also by the Office of Department of Health and Human Services. And so this program is a very intense program for a very, very vulnerable group of people that are selected to come to the United States. So we provide what we call a pre-arrival service, getting things ready to welcome a newcomer. We have core services, and we do all those things in 90 days. And then we have what we call post-arrival services, where we offer employment, we offer cash medical assistance, and community supports, some of those of which people are eligible for up to 5 years. And the picture you see here is a Burmese Karen family of eight arriving at Logan Airport. With I think I brought that much luggage with me on this trip, and that was eight people. And so what are the required evaluations? How do we measure what we're doing in resettlement? I've noticed some academic literature on how we really could be doing better work on how we're measuring, and I fully agree with that. Because when I look at what we measure, which is these required evaluations that we have to turn into the federal agencies, we do a 90-day service report. Does the person know how to recite his address? Does the person know where the grocery store is? These reports don't really reflect, they reflect more on what the agency did, more on what the agency taught or didn't teach that person. Was there adequate furniture in the apartment? All of which are very important, but it's not looking at how is that person adjusting. We measure, did they go to two health appointments, two required health assessments? Again, important because we want people to be healthy, but not getting at their quality of life or how they're progressing on the continuum that is resettlement. We look at employment placement, which has for long been the really sole indicator of how well you're performing as an agency. And so agencies can be, you know, penalized with reduced funding if their employment numbers are falling below what the federal standards are. We look at employment retention rates and reduction of cash assistance. So this is another big marker. So how quickly can a refugee be employed and self-sufficient and no longer need public benefit services? And so again, we're tracked, you know, after 8 months, have you gotten that person a job? Can the person pay their rent? And if not, then something's wrong with the agency. And it's also in a place like in Boston, for example, where the cost of living is very high, this is a really difficult metric for us to meet. It puts a lot of stress on the refugee. And then we have on-site monitoring from the feds and from our national affiliate. I was thinking about some other measures for consideration. You know, what is the participation of refugees and immigrants in the workforce that serves this population? So I looked at my own staff. 12 of them are first or second generation immigrants or refugees. And then I looked at all the staff that work in Massachusetts resettlement agencies, which we call voluntary agencies, and 50% of those are former refugees or immigrants themselves. So I think that's a sign of some success. People able to take a job and then in return be helping others. We have a lot of what we call mutual assistance or self-help agencies in Massachusetts, and we have 10 of them, and all of them are led by former refugees. Again, I think another sign of people becoming integrated, being able to take grant monies, federal funds, to be able to help their own communities. At charities, we do have a Haitian Multi-Service Center, which is one of the few centers in the country that's specifically designed to serve the Haitian community, which is the third largest in Boston, Massachusetts. And leadership or participation in faith communities. So I was looking at our ethnic apostolates in the Archdiocese, and we have newer apostolates, especially for the Iraqi, mainly Chaldean, and the Ethiopian, Eritrean, and of course we have the Vietnamese apostolate. So we have and these are just some of the refugee ones that I highlighted, because I believe the number is somewhere upwards of like 40 or so. Groups that we have is very high. And then the Karen Baptist Church in Lynn, where you saw those beautiful girls singing. I think that's a real example of how a community integrates into a larger mainstream. And we actually, in that community, have one of the two Burmese pastors who was able to get his, I'm sorry to mess this up, but he was able to be, I don't know if you call it professed in the Christian or but he's a Baptist minister and he got his credentials here. And so they fly him all over the place to perform the sacraments in their native language. And so that's just a little bit about us, and I hope that I've given you a chance of some ways to think about some different measures for the work you're doing with refugees and immigrants. Thank you. Very good. Thank you. Well, I'm Sister Norma Pimentel, and I would like to begin and share with you how it all started since last year. All of you know the big wave of immigrants that came starting, especially in the summer of last year. But on that very first day that we got involved, I don't think, for me it's very important to share those first experiences because it's the pace of what happened afterwards. And one of the things that happened right that very first day was that as I was going to the bus station to respond to the immigrants back in June, I had no idea what was about to unfold for me the days after that. So much so that I called Father Tom, who is a pastor of Sacred Heart, two blocks away from the bus station. And I asked him, Father Tom, can I borrow your parish hall for a couple of days? Well, to this day, we're still there. It's way over a year. So neither he nor I knew what we were about to be facing. But, you know, different from many other years or all the immigration that we've had right at the border, is that this time, it was children. That's what we were seeing. Thousands of children. They were at the border. And that's what made such a big difference. And that very first experience that I had when I walked into the processing centers at the Border Patrol where the children were being kept in great numbers because they had no other choice because they were children and there's no other option but to detain them and keep them there in those processing centers that were so small, they could all barely hold 300 people. And yet, they had thousands. And most of them, if not all, were children. And that was very significant because when I walked into that processing center, and I walked into it and I asked them, nobody had ever come back in yet. It was sort of like it was a hush-hush for the Border Patrol. They wanted to resolve it before it got out. But unfortunately, people started to ask questions then. And so when we opened the respite center in Sacred Heart, it brought attention to the whole issue of what was happening at the border. And therefore, I was able to get into the processing center and asked to go in and be with the children. And it was tiny little cells with hundreds of the children all around me. They haven't had a chance to bathe. They were all dirty, muddy, they were crying. Barely could even sit down because they're all standing up, barely just lying against one another. Tiny ones, 4 or 5 years old, very small. They were all crying. They were telling me, "Sácame de aquí, take me out of here. I can't breathe." It was so suffocating in there that the experience that I felt, it was terrible. I couldn't believe that here in the United States, we had no other option but that. It was bad. We started to pray together. We were all crying, and we could even see through the windows where the Border Patrol officers were looking in. The very first time, they saw the children very different. So much so that the chief of the Border Patrol told me, "Thank you, sister, for helping us see them as human beings." Because it was so overwhelming for them. They had no other choice but to keep them there until Plan B was there, which was another place to put the children, because there were unaccompanied children. That night, I went back to the Sacred Heart Respite Center, the Welcome Center,
it makes so much sense to me why we were there. The importance of us reaching out and welcoming these families that have already been through what an ordeal, going through all their countries and getting there, detained by immigration for days, weeks, not just 1 week. They were there in that condition for many days and finally able to be released. And that night arrived and see some of those kids that I had just prayed with at a welcome center. The children came running to me, hugging me. Unbelievable. Almost as if I was the one that magically did something to help them get out of that situation where they were. It was so wonderful. It makes so much sense how we were able to be there for them. It is that what made such an impact. Now, how we were able to come together as a community. And I think as I think now, how do I measure success? It's measured by the response that we had to engage everybody to come together and welcome the families, the children, to put aside our differences, whether political or whatever, and to join together in a response to say, I want to help the mother and the child. I know how the city government came to visit me one of the very first days, and they asked me, sister, what are you doing here? Because they saw whole parish hall full of people, volunteers, resources, everything. We were very engaged all day until late hours of the night. And what are you doing here, sister? And I said, I'm restoring human dignity. That response captured his attention. And so did all of the city government and county government, the border patrol, everybody joined forces in wanting to do the same. We were all together in one response, which was, let us help restore human dignity. And I think that's what is key in the success. It got national attention. We got the attention of the Holy Father, which is so nice. But I think that's what I believe was so successful in our response to help so many families. And to this day, we're still there. And I'm going to start moving the slides. These slides are just of what we did. Some of the volunteers are many, thousands of them. Just the weekend of 4th of July, we had 1,000 volunteers. And of course, with the help of so many people, Catholic Church would say, was right there with us as well, right from the start. We had every single denomination, every single group participating and helping the families feel welcome. The most important part was the fact that when the immigrant family, the mother, the children, walked through that door, they were welcomed with an applause. And that moment, you would see the mother break into tears of joy. They couldn't believe that here in the United States, we were welcoming them. And so this is the Sacred Heart Welcome Center in McAllen, Texas. One of the things that the city of McAllen, the very first day, said, sister, if I had a magic wand, what would that little magic wand do for you? How about some showers? And that night we had showers, eight showers, and the mothers were able to take a shower, and believe me, it made such a wonderful difference when they would be able to go in and shower and clean up and bathe. And so, Thank you so much.
So there are certainly some common themes there, I'd say. Peg talked about the leadership of Catholic institutions. Is that absolutely crucial to their existence and necessarily for them operating as effective integrated agencies? And Father Clete spoke of integration in the workplace and through citizenship and in the broader society, and these issues all being connected, and then also the importance of partnerships, how crucial they are, that we can't be effective in silos. I think his example of the Catholic labor priest is the need to be open to new ministries, but also to be open to revitalizing old ministries. Margene talked about integrated services and the constant focus on human persons is crucial to the effectiveness of faith-based agencies as integrated agencies. And she also lifted up the issue of refugees and immigrants taking leadership roles in Catholic agencies and faith communities as a really important sign of integration. And Sister Norma, the first step in the narrative that she told was welcome. The first integration step was welcoming and tending to the needs of people. But again, a vital ingredient in this work is allowing potential partners to see the human face of the people that are being served, and not writing off people that may be partners. And success is also engaging a broad community of people in need to work together to restore the dignity of people whose dignity has been denied. So let me ask you all to, first of all, if you have questions, but also if you have thoughts on this issue, and you have a wealth of experience and talent and background in our group on how we measure success, how we measure our work with immigrants. So if you have questions or if you'd like to speak to those issues, please come forward. We have a good 25 minutes here. We'd really like to have an exchange of speakers. Please, if you would, come to the microphone.
Well, first of all, thank you very much for your presentations, Sister Norma. Gracias. You know, as a father, of a 4 and a 2-year-old, I could not even imagine my children not being they, you know? So, thank you for the word. I just wanted to make a quick comment rather than a question regarding connecting Peggy and Father Clete's presentations. Catholic schools certainly make such a big difference in the and it has made it in the lives of Catholics in the United States. By the 1950s, 55% of all Catholic children in the United States went to Catholic schools. And we know the huge difference that represented vis-a-vis clergy, sisters, theologians, Catholic school leaders, social leaders. Today, as we were saying, only 3% of Hispanic children in the United States benefit from Catholic schools. Unfortunately, we will not be able to have half of the kids, of Hispanic kids in Catholic schools. Right now, 12.4 million there are 12.4 million Hispanic children, or Hispanic people under the age of 18 living in the United States. So there are not enough Catholic schools for them. So the question is, what can we do then if we cannot bring it to Catholic schools, then how can we advocate for better education in the public school system? And that's what brings me to Father Clete's presentation. I think that we need to start getting, as Catholics, we need to get more involved in what's going on in the public school system. 70% of Hispanic children in the United States go to underperforming, failing schools. This is the majority of our children, our Catholic children, will not go to college because they are not receiving the most basic education in public schools. So yes, advocate for Catholic schools, but the largest body, the 97%, is going to the public school system, and unfortunately, it's a system that is failing our Hispanic Catholic kids.
I think we have to do both. I think we have to increase the number because there are places available for many Latino students at the Catholic schools that remain open. We should build some in places like Texas where the Catholic population has been surging to the extent that financially we can. We need to figure out ways of integrating the students who are not going to the Catholic schools within that faith community. I know I'm an RCIA sponsor at the moment. I came from through RCIA myself for an immigrant woman living with 9 children in a horrific situation. We need to help people like that through our churches as well.
Just to your point, Osman, last week in Chicago, Archbishop Supich spoke to the Chicago Federation of Labor and he confirmed what you just said. He said that the majority of the Catholic children who live within the boundaries of the Archdiocese of Chicago are in public schools. And that he was quite clear that the Archdiocese of Chicago is committed to quality public education. At the same time, he challenged the labor movement in Chicago with the fact that the majority of the children in the inner city schools, Catholic schools, are not Catholic. And he asked the broader community to help us sustain those inner city schools. So I think it was the right message, and it probably needs to be repeated in many other places.
Yes. And could you identify yourselves?
Sure. Good morning. Welcome to the order. I'm Father Bob Mosier with the Colombian Fathers here at the Colombian Mission Center. I was kind of intrigued by the presentation at the end of Marjane Perhoff's presentation, Ms. Perhoff. The ethnically based faith communities that immigrants become a part of, would you just say a few words about how they help the integration into society and avoid the temptation to ghettoize their ethnic identity? Could you say a few words about that?
I don't work at the Archdiocese, but this has just been my observation of these groups. I've noticed that there is a real concentrated effort by the Office of Outreach and Cultural Diversity at the Archdiocese to not allow for that ghettoization that you mentioned. So for example, when we do have gatherings, it's a bringing together of all the ethnic leadership. So I was able to be with them a couple months back. You know, over 90 people attended of all the different ethnic groups and all the ethnic pastoral associates and came together to talk about the conference that's going to be on the families, to talk about immigration reform issues. So I think that gathering and convening of them, and the diocese does, like, offers the sessions twice so that people can keep coming. I have noticed also a real concentrated effort to ensure that many of these aren't, they don't have their own churches, so they're using churches in other cities, and so they're also bringing that aspect of it together. So if people are worshiping, they'll have like a Chaldean mass, for example, for the Iraqis, and they'll celebrate specific Chaldean festivals is not the right word, but then at the same time, all of those are also, all those people are also in other parishes. So I think that's what, I mean, and I could certainly be happy to put you in touch with Father Michael Harrington, who oversees that. My point was just to show that it's how refugees and immigrants can become those leaders. In fact, one of our former caseworkers is very active in the Chaldean community, and some of our Ethiopian interpreters are in the so I'm not sure if that totally answers your question, but I do see a really concentrated effort at the archdiocesan level for that.
Good morning, I'm Michael Siefert. I live in Bradford, Texas. My wife is a pediatrician, and both were engaged in some way with kids coming through. And one, so this is more of a comment, for measuring the effects of a national response to this crisis. One problem, and Ruben Garcia spoke to this really well, is that the kids don't stay here. The families move through and they go all over the United States, and we tracked some of them. I'd get out my phone number, call me when you get to where you're going if you have any trouble. They would call from Sioux City, Iowa. They would call from Birmingham, Alabama. They'd call from all over the country. And the place we could find to send them every time, the only place we were confident was Catholic Charities. Contact your Catholic Charities. If you're not Catholic, don't worry. Go to the parish and ask for that help. But one of the problems that we found is that national lawyers wanted to step up and help, but there wasn't a way to integrate. Where are these people? How do we find them? How do we let them know we want to do this? As well as the pediatricians especially, to give out kids who've not only gone through physical trauma, but also some psychological stuff. So I think it's a place where the church actually could serve in a tremendous way as a sacrament of integration of these kinds of services. So it's more of a comment rather than a question, but we did find it missing. And this is one small piece of a huge immigration problem, but the kids are not going away. That immigration is continuing across the borders. It's on our plates still. Thank you.
Thank you for all your very, very insightful comments. And I have a question. This is I'm Vanna Slaughter with Catholic Charities in Dallas. I direct the Immigration Legal Services Program there. And I lived through the surge last summer along with Sister Lana, but we were less impacted than she. But I have a question from the kind of trench worker perspective. And that is, what wisdom do you have with respect to overcoming the ever-increasing, it seems, partner vetting frenzy that we experience working as diocesan workers throughout the Catholic Church, and the constraints that I think keep us from being, from having effective, spontaneous responses to crises as we have last summer because of all the state environment constraints that we have?
I think that's on. There we go. I think there are two questions. And we mentioned safe environments. I don't know if that's particular internal church language for those working with children. So let me just set that piece aside. I think you raised another question about partnerships and who's in the partnerships and who's in the coalition, and I think we can't be naive about that. It's always a challenge. It's always going to be a challenge for us. I don't think we should step back from it, but I think we have to be vigilant. We have to know that our partners are real partners. Sometimes it happens, I know it happened in an area I'm more familiar with, that the major coalition got off track from immigration and got into marriage issues. And the whole thing just blew up. That's unfortunate. But I think that the real key thing is when we can focus on the particular persons we're trying to serve and their immediate needs, that's the broadest way to get people into the coalition and stay focused on that. I think years ago, Monsignor Higgins, for decades really, advised the labor movement to stay focused on the issues of workers, their wages, and their rights, and not get into the culture wars. And I think that's actually one of the reasons there's been some fraying in the relationship, for example, between labor and the church.
Thank you.
We do best when we stay focused on what brings us together in the first place. And I think earlier this morning, you know, when I was listening to Sister Norman, when you look at the children, keep focused on those children, and we can all stay in the conversation. The minute we get into how are they going to vote 30 years from now and what their issue, you know, we're going to get in trouble. I'd say stay focused on the children, stay focused on those mothers, stay focused on the immigrants, keep it personal, and it works best, be my advice. And I think that's true from the labor side of things as well, because they don't want to get too tainted by the church, you know what I mean? So keep focused.
Hello, how are you guys? My name is Maria Palacios, and I am one of the Assumptions volunteers with the Assumption Sisters. So I have a question for Professor Brennings. So most of your research has been with like urban institutions and how Catholic education affects them, right? I went to an all-girls private Catholic high school, the Academy of Our Lady of Mercy Hall in Milford, Connecticut. And so I was just wondering what you thought about their involvement and their responsibility as a Catholic organization with immigration. More, not so much about, you know, helping the Latinos there, but more of creating a conscience of being for immigration. I mean, I was in my class, in my home when I was there, we could barely, the minorities that could barely fit, could fill up one classroom because we were very small. And so I never saw any events, any organizations that dealt with immigration. It was more about women empowerment but immigration was never touched upon. And so I was just wondering how you would promote that involvement of immigration, the issue in Catholic schools that are predominantly white with more resources that can do more activism or be more involved with the movement.
I think there are a couple of ways. One is through the schools and one is through the parishes. I am fortunate to be in a wealthy parish, and we tithe a tenth of our offerings every week to support a struggling, largely Latino school on the other side of town. And the pastor from that school just came and gave the homily. Gave a homily at church that was to all the masses, talking about what a difference that made and how by not sort of forcing our culture on their church and letting them do their own thing, it was the right way. The other thing is that one of the pictures I showed of a lot of young women in graduation outfits was from a school that sounds a lot like yours. And it's called Notre Dame Academy in Milwaukee, and it's 98% Latina. And the parents who are mostly immigrants, mostly first generation immigrants, don't contribute financially to those schools, but contribute through working, so that the parents become involved, and as they do, they are directed to social services that can help them. And more of the really successful Catholic schools are becoming sort of the opening place to getting more services of all kinds for the parents involved, immigration and other things.
Yes, the involvement of parents I think is very important, but I think it's hard when parents of immigrant children don't speak the language and or aren't as educated themselves. Because I'm an immigrant myself, and so going to this Catholic school, my parents were never involved because they couldn't speak the language. And so I feel like parent involvement is very limited because of that, and sometimes the Catholic schools don't provide that, especially predominantly white schools. So.
I think one of the things is you have to have bilingual resources at those schools. If they're not doing that, it's really hard.
You lose the opportunity.
don't do it. Some of the schools are very successful in having, teaching the parents with small children to read to their children in English and in Spanish, and providing dual language books for them, so that there are a number of ways that you can do that, so that you're not just helping the children, which of course in another generation will be wonderful, loving people like you, but also not losing the opportunity to minister to the parents as well.
Thank you. But I just wanted to follow up on your question, though, which was a very good one. And I think one thing we've looked at in the Archdiocese of Boston with the Catholic schools is the need for interpreters. So by having bilingual staff people is good, but those parents also need access to interpreters. And in the public schools, it's a mandate, right? But in our Catholic schools, it's not. And that one of the biggest challenges we found across the board to get Hispanic children, the Latino children into our schools, was they didn't have interpreters. And so we've now partnered with our interpreter services, and some of the Catholic schools have agreed to spend a little money, because it's not free, you know, to translate their websites, translate their enrollment forms. There's also a Hispanic enrollment initiative that's funded at the Catholic Schools Foundation, which has greatly helped to increase the number of Latino children in our Catholic schools.
Good morning. My name is Kathy Curran, and I'm with the Catholic Health Association in Washington, D.C. We represent Catholic hospitals and nursing homes around the country, and I want to thank the center and the sponsors for a really great project and a great session. And two things in the panel prompted me to come up. One was Father, please comment about breakouts out of silos, and also the idea of how do we measure success. And I wanted to share a thought and an invitation. So obviously, Catholic hospitals and nursing homes serve immigrants in many different ways, often in partnership with Catholic charities. But I wanted to share one program that's relatively new at Loyola University Medical School in Chicago, where Trinity Health System is sponsoring funding so that undocumented students can go to medical school. Now that with the Dreamer Act, they can work because they have work permits, so they can do their clinical pieces. So the first year there were 7 students, and now 14 students were helping them, since they can't qualify for federal student loans, helping them to get their tuition and food. So that's an example of a little bit of an out-of-the-box way that Catholic healthcare can help, in this case, undocumented immigrants to become integrated into the system. And there are other examples in the employment way where systems are helping immigrants to get entry-level positions in healthcare. So that's kind of the thinking outside the silo piece. And the long-term, how do we measure success piece is related to that, because particularly Hispanics are so underrepresented in leadership positions in many industries, but particularly in healthcare, they're underrepresented in the medical field. So looking long-term at our success, one way we're going to measure success is what are we doing now to build the leadership positions and prepare people for leadership positions in the future. And I think that's one way that we're trying to advance the ball in lots of different ways in Catholic healthcare. And the invitation I wanted to offer is, again, break down silos. Think about the Catholic hospitals and systems in your communities when you need help. Margene just talked about interpreters in Catholic schools. Hospitals have to have interpreter services. So reach out to your hospitals. Maybe they have interpreters they can share with you. Maybe they can at least help you figure out how to find interpretation services through your school, Catholic school. But remember that Catholic Hospital is one of your partners, not just on healthcare, but in all lots of different ways that we can help to integrate immigrants into our society. So I didn't really have a question, but I wanted to share that. Thank you.
Kathy, if I could just respond to that. I know a parish in Chicago that I was associated with leaned on the neighboring Catholic hospitals to provide resource people for a women's leadership program we had in the parish. They came in and did things like healthy, cholesterol, low, Mexican cuisine, things like that. They did sort of mental health issues for women, immigrant mothers, and dealing with family issues and kinds of things like that. We could never have done that. So those are terrific resources. Thanks.
Good morning. I'm Linda Hartke from Lutheran Immigration and
refugee service, and I have two questions. One echoes an earlier interest, which is the long-term process of assessing and measuring successful integration. It's much easier to assess what happens in the short term when someone needs immediate protection or when their life is being stabilized as a newcomer in this country. But we need to be able to learn over the long term what interventions make the biggest difference and could be scaled up, even in those early years, to have a greater impact long term. So we'd be interested if there's any thinking on your part to that question. And secondly is a question about hard data. As people of faith, we're very good at telling stories and at the anecdotal evidence. It's compelling, it evokes emotion and support and volunteers and an outpouring that is important for our work. But it's also hard data that can shape our work to be more effective, have a greater impact, and ultimately change public policies and practices. So my second question is if any of you have particular examples of using data in your work to inform your work, to do it differently, to stop something, to start something new, or to push policymakers to improve.
I'm an economist, and that was largely my role in this Catholic Schools project. And so data is my life. But we have our economics department at Notre Dame is connected with Catholic Charities to do long-term evaluation on projects that minister to the poor, not specifically immigration, although that's a part of what they do. And I would be glad to get anyone in touch with those folks. If you have a particular project, I know there's a new initiative that Catholic Charities just was awarded, and what they'll do is they'll help you set up ways of collecting the most effective data that will show you over the long term something that will be very powerful. I think the success that our book project has had comes from the fact that it's based on hard data, data that's not necessarily costly to collect except in terms of thinking about it and in terms of time. So it can be done, it's just a question of finding people who know how to do the right work.
I'd like to respond in two ways. Again, I'm going to do this from the labor perspective. Labor organizing is all about building political power and participation in the democracy. In California, in the election when Jerry Brown was elected governor, it was overwhelmingly immigrants and immigrant members in labor who framed the campaign this way. You could vote for Jerry Brown or you could vote for SB 1070. They never mentioned the other candidate's name. They just referred to her as SB 1070. Jerry Brown won in a landslide, right? In Nevada right now, anybody who wants to run for president is probably going to have to get Nevada. It's a swing state. The largest block of voters in Nevada are immigrants. I could get you numbers, but they're very concrete. In Texas, we know there are 1 million Latinos who could be naturalized and could vote. 1 million African Americans who are citizens who can be registered to vote. 2 million voters would change the politics, I'm sure, in certain counties in this state. That's one piece. In other places, when you look at the numbers and concrete things, you know, you wanna look at things like wages, and from the labor perspective, in the immigrant community. The local union in Chicago that I work with developed a video for a campaign of food service workers at O'Hare Airport. They tracked where they lived, they gathered a group of pastors together, and they showed them if those folks got union jobs, and the priest sat there and looked, they saw this map, this section of the city, they could identify where their parishes was, this would have been true for any denomination could have identified that they had churches in this particular part of the city. And then this map showed up, if these folks got this raise, if they got this union contract, this much more money would come into that neighborhood. Then the video began to say, what does this mean for schools, Catholic schools? What does it mean for small businesses in the neighborhood? You begin to get very quantified very quickly. And I would say to a person, those pastors are like, I know we never talk about this inside the church, but the term self-interest, this was definitely in our self-interest.
Good morning. My name is Pat Delgado, and I'm here in El Paso. And is this more of a comment, because it resonates with what you're talking about? We've been starting in the diocese to focus on restorative justice more, and specifically the idea of encouraging parishes to become more welcoming, supportive communities for people that have problems with the criminal justice system. Because these people usually don't mention that. You know, they're either ashamed of it or they think it's not a problem that they bring up at church. So we're trying to encourage that. And to me, I think that the diocese really should be pushing and encouraging parishes to take on, not as a burden, but as an opportunity to reach out to families. And most of our kids are not in Catholic schools now, and most of the parishes don't have Catholic schools, but they all have CCD programs. And these families show up, and they show up at the wrong time. You know, registration has already been closed, the books have been ordered, and the focus is on, you know, preparation for sacraments and all. And I'm not trying to lay a heavier burden on the catechists or the DREs, but I think that this is a pool of people who are reaching out. They don't even know what they need, but the parishes could really respond to them at that time. They're transient. Many of them aren't even going to stay a whole year, but we could really use the parish structure and the diocesan structure to reach out more to these families. And the, I think it's a win-win, you know, because and encourage our Anglo communities also to respond to this.
Thank you. I think, do we have a couple more comments, questions? Are you in line? No? Yes. Why don't we take the two more and then we'll respond and then we'll have
Buenos días.
Buenos días.
Me llamo Claudia Díaz y soy directora organizativa de la Red Fronteriza por los Derechos Humanos. Y estoy aquí pues para felicitarles el trabajo tan difícil que están desempeñando. Nosotros trabajamos aquí en el Paso Sur de Nuevo México tratando de educar a nuestras comunidades sobre sus derechos humanos y civiles. Sabemos que la integración pues es muy difícil para uno de inmigrante. Y nosotros trabajamos todos los días con esas comunidades que no pueden hablar el idioma inglés, que nosotros creemos que debemos de estar pensando en hacer esos cambios sociales, políticos, económicos, igual que ustedes. Así que pues, los felicito por hacer este trabajo y que es dificilísimo, pero lo vamos a lograr poco a poco.
Buenas tardes, buenos días, ¿cómo? Mi nombre es Irma Cruz y también pertenezco a la Red Fronteriza por los Derechos Humanos. Yo también quiero agradecerles que nos traigan sus historias de cómo ustedes han participado en la integración de los inmigrantes. Yo creo que a los niños no acompañados dormimos aquí en El Paso y con la misma respuesta de la comunidad. Yo creo que hay mucha voluntad de todas las personas, no solo católicas, sino toda la comunidad en general, de dar la bienvenida y ayudar a las personas inmigrantes. Y yo creo que la Iglesia católica, ¿verdad?, es una parte muy poderosa, una fuerza muy poderosa en los Estados Unidos. Yo creo que sería muy bueno que nos apoyaran mucho más, ¿verdad?, en nuestra lucha que estamos haciendo como comunidad. Nosotros trabajamos con la comunidad y lo vemos día a día, el temor a salir con los hijos a la escuela, el temor a manejar sin una licencia, varias cosas que uno no se imagina que la gente vive con ese temor. Entonces sí, yo les pediría, con mucho respeto, mucha ganas, ¿verdad?, y que esto no quede aquí, que nos ayuden a pasar una reforma migratoria integral. Gracias.
I think we're going to have to not have more questions because we're 10 minutes over right now. Come back for the next session and make your comment. Any final comments here? I wanted to thank the Border Network too, that does such terrific work. And I've been fortunate myself to be on the board and to be associated with them for maybe 15 years or so now. So thank you to you all for the wonderful organizing, community building work that you're doing.